Flint's Water and the American Urban Tragedy, was published in 2018 and was chosen as a 2019 Michigan Notable Book. Her writing has appeared in Elle Magazine, The New York Times, Politico, Next City, and other publications. She was a correspondent for the Columbia Journalism Review as part of its United States project for nearly 5 years. Clark was part of the 2017 class of Knight Wallace Journalism Fellows at the University of Michigan. She edited a Detroit anthology, which was a 2015 Michigan Notable Book, and is the author of Michigan Literary Luminaries from Elmore Leonard to Robert Hayden. She's the founder of Literary Detroit and has been the director of applications for Write a House, which renovates longtime vacant homes in Detroit and gives them away to writers. She was also a writer in residence in Detroit high schools through the Inside Out Literary Arts Project for 4 years. She has been a longtime co-leader of an improv theater workshop at Men's Prison in Macomb County, Michigan. Clark was a Fulbright Fellow in Nairobi, Kenya, and received the 2017 Excellence in Environmental Journalism Award from the Great Lakes Environmental Law Council. Her writing was a notable pick in Best American Sports Writing, 2012, Best Commentary Finalist from the 2015 Mirror Awards, and a 2016 First Place Winner from the Society of Professional Journalists Detroit in Online Investigative Reporting. She also served as a contributing editor at Waxwing Literary Journal, where she especially liked to review literature and translation. A graduate of the University of Michigan's Residential College, she also holds an MFA from the Warren Wilson Program for Writers, where she focused on fiction. She currently lives and works in Detroit. So please join me in welcoming Anna Clark.
Hi, everyone. This is so great to be here. First of all, it's my very first time in the Troy Community Center, and I needed somebody to rescue me because I was just dazzled by how much is here and how active and engaged it is. And I'm especially grateful to be here as part of the programming of the public library, which is a really lovely place. And everybody I've met there has been just wonderful. And I know this isn't news to you, but I just wanted to say that it's impressive and beautiful, and I'm grateful to just be here. So thank you. I thought where we would start tonight is to talk about the water, right? Let's, kind of pan out for a minute. We here in Michigan are surrounded by more than one-fifth of all the fresh water on the face of the planet, right? We boast of being the Great Lakes State and pure Michigan and having the third coast, which apparently the Gulf of Mexico coast also calls himself that, but the fourth coast isn't, nobody wants to be that. but this water is amazing, right? Like this isn't, you know this. This is like, it's so vast. It's the surface area is about equivalent to the surface area of the United Kingdom. I mean, there's so much water in these five lakes that if you poured it out over the 48 contiguous, lower contiguous states, it would fill the Grand Canyon before settling at an even depth of 10 feet. It's given us more coastline than any other state except Alaska. And this is just going with those five inland seas. I mean, throughout our state, we're also rich with smaller lakes and rivers and creeks and this abundance that is absolutely dazzling, right? And besides being part of our economic and recreational life, it's also part of our emotional life, our spiritual life even. I know this personally as a little kid who grew up near Lake Michigan, that this isn't just scenery that we're talking about here, right? It's had a profound effect on everybody who lives here. You know, this is an important part of our lives and our communities. And yet somehow, in the midst of this wealth of water, we've got to a situation where an entire city could not drink its own from its own taps. Not for a short time, but for a long time. And this didn't happen because of a natural disaster or because some short-sighted company was cutting corners, you know, blinded by profit. It was rather the active choices, the man-made decisions of a number of different people in the very public agencies that are meant to protect our water and our public health that led to this disastrous situation for a Great Lakes city. Now, I'm sure there are folks in the room who know Flint very well. Maybe you're from there, maybe you worked there, maybe you went to school there, but just in case, I want to bring a little bit of the spirit of the city into this room. So Flint is a city of about just under 100,000 people. It's got very sunny, beautiful cafes throughout that serve as neighborhood nerve centers like Troy. It's got a really fantastic public library that serves all kinds of people, has a really robust programming schedule, and it's right in the middle of the cultural center, which is a real jewel in the city. It's got a very distinctive modernist city hall. That dome is where a lot of public meetings that were very influential in the trajectory of the water crisis took place. It's got also the home of a Burston Fieldhouse. Any famous athlete you ever heard of that came through Flint has probably had some connection to Burston. It fell into disrepair in later years, but there's a guy who's now a county commissioner who has been, you know, single-handedly in many ways been reviving it, and it's full of life nowadays. In the summers, if you go there on a Sunday, it's just basically like a neighborhood festival with barbecue and all-day intramural softball. It's really fun. And it's also the home of four different colleges, including the University of Michigan, Flint, and Kettering, and Mott Community College, and Baker College. It's the home of the largest planetarium in the state. That's where I watched the eclipse a little while ago. It was great. And it's also very proud of its farmers market. That actually, fun fact, that used to be the printing plant for the newspaper. that historic building was on the other side of the parking lot. So this vacant newspaper plant building, you know, became this really beautiful space for food, community, neighborhood shops, things like that. And of course, it's also the stage for where this drinking water crisis unfolded. So we are almost at the 5-year anniversary of this infamous water switch. It was on April 25th, 2014. I'm going to go over just the basic facts of what happened in a super quick fashion. But basically, the city of Flint had been relying on Great Lakes water through Detroit for about 50 years. And while it had a number of concerns, including affordability of the water and its ability to participate in having a say in its own contract and, you know, negotiating power, it had some concerns, but the quality of the water was good. Now, the city in April 2014 decided it was going to leave the Detroit water system and join a brand new water system called by acronym the KWA, the Karagundy Water Authority. That was going to take water from Lake Huron as well, although the city of Flint would be responsible for treating that lake water itself. Now, this water system wasn't even built yet, and in the interim, the idea was that the city would reboot its old water plant and treat water from the Flint River for 2 or so years until the KWA was ready to go. One important thing to mention is that Flint was under emergency management. It was for 3.5 years when all of the key decisions happened related to the water crisis. This is meaningful because, as I'm sure you know, this meant that the elected leadership in the city, its city council people, its mayor, had no authority to make any decisions about what happened. So under emergency management, they decided they were going to switch. And this was celebrated at this press conference that everybody in these images deeply regrets. You can see the emergency manager there, the mayor, the city council people, folks from the MDQ. And even beyond that, there were people who were excited about this switch, really feeling like it was an opportunity for the city to regain its sovereignty. You know, this is us getting back to our roots. We can take care of ourselves. We're leaving the huge utility, you know, to the south. We're going to do our own thing now. Here's to Flint, as the toast went. Now, one of the myths about the water crisis is that the Flint River itself was so polluted that by the time it got to people's taps, it made people sick. Now, there's some truth in this because the Flint River, like urban waterways all over the country, was treated so badly for so long. Rivers in particular that went through cities were literally treated as open sewers. There was not a single regulation and no enforceable regulation on what you could dump into the water or how much of it you could dump into the water until the 1970s. So like peak industrial age, these rivers were, disgusting. I mean, Chicago, it was so bad that they literally reversed their river and sending it down to St. Louis to the unhappiness of the folks in St. Louis. So folks in Flint grew up learning to be very wary of this river water, right? You know, they're warned, don't swim in it, don't drink from it, don't eat the fish you catch from it. People shared stories of weird things they would see in it. It was in terrible condition for a very long time. And it still has some issues with it, but we also have had about 40 years of the Clean Water Act and deindustrialization, frankly, that have contributed to the river's healing process. And there have also been some folks in volunteer groups, especially like the ones that led this kayak trip, who have been working very hard to try to host cleanups and help build back a relationship between the waterway and the people who live through it. The river itself wasn't the problem. The problem was its treatment or lack thereof. So basically, it's intuitive, right? If you take a gallon of Lake Huron water and a gallon of river water, any river water, the river water is going to be cloudier, right? It's just going to have more stuff in it. It's more complex to treat than lake water. That old city plant that was rebooted did not have the staffing or the technical upgrades sufficient to treat the more complex water source, which may have had something to do with the fact that they were only planning on doing it temporarily for a few years. Significantly, it was not treated with something called corrosion control, which is what was breaking federal law. So corrosion control is what you're supposed to add to the water at the treatment plant so that when the water passes through what is almost universally very old pipes, it helps prevent the metals from corroding into it. Especially significant when so many of our pipes all across America are made out of lead, which is one of the world's best known neurotoxins, and we do not want it on our water. Corrosion control is not a complete fix. There's still a lot of reasons why we need to get rid of lead in our drinking water systems, but it helps a lot, and especially when the river water we're working with is more corrosive than the lake water that had previously been going through the pipes. So you got a more corrosive water source, and you're not treating it with corrosion control, not for a short time, but for a very long time. So it's intuitive what would happen. The pipes are going to corrode. And these are literal pipes that were pulled out of Flint. When you saw people holding water bottles that were orange or brown, that was literally rust that had corroded into it from the iron of the drinking water infrastructure. What you couldn't see was lead, which was not visible to the eye, or a number of other water issues that the city had to deal with that didn't get the spotlight that lead did, including a series of E. coli bacterial violations, a Safe Drinking Water Act violation for something called TTHMs, which is a carcinogen, basically, and a two-year outbreak of Legionnaires' disease, which is a very severe type of pneumonia that is caused by waterborne bacteria. So when you're taking a shower or a bath, like, and you're breathing in, like water vapors, that's how it can kind of get into your lungs. And there was a two-year outbreak of this that literally killed people. Though none of this was made public until after the fact. So this is how we get into this surreal situation where you have the city of Flint, which is 70 miles from Lake Huron in one direction and 70 miles from Saginaw Bay in the other, facing the fact that water is a threat. It's not life-giving, it is life-taking. It is something that you have to think about not just when you're thirsty for a glass of water, but when you cook, when you make your coffee, when you're making ice cubes, when you're making the formula you feed your babies. I met one woman who is a community health professional. Health is her background. She was in the habit of keeping a crock pot next to her bathtub so that she could fill with water bottles and then, you know, warm them up and then toss it into the tub because she didn't trust the water coming, you know, out the other way. There was a series of other, sort of to this day, kind of unexplained complaints, including rashes and hair loss and other sort of symptoms that it's not quite clear where they came from, but were prevalent enough and observable enough that you can't dismiss it. It's just such an intimate betrayal. I mean, one mother would talk about how she would try to be a good parent, right? Like, she's trying to help her kids to avoid soda and juice. She's like encouraging them to drink water, and then to find out that that water was making them sick. Not just sick for a little bit, but with lead, that when children absorb it, its consequences are irreversible and permanent. Like, I mean, it soaks into your bones and your brain, and it can have a severe effect on your development. And that's one reason, that's one thing that people mean when they say that the Flint water crisis isn't over. I mean, to a certain extent, we just have to wait for these kids to grow up, right? I mean, the water wasn't the only input of lead. I mean, there's the residue of lead paint and leaded fuel everywhere, but it is a unique betrayal to find that the policy choices that led to this water being less safe than it should be it's just haunting. And I've been thinking about it for a few years, and it still kind of gives me a chill. But one of the things I wanted to do with this book was to not just give a sort of chronology of the last few years as much as I felt like that might be of use. I wanted to kind of look at the bigger questions of how does this happen in a city, right? What's the larger context here? And for this, I looked back to Flint in the 1960s. This is where that picture comes from. So Flint, about at the time it hooked onto Detroit's water system for the first time, it did so because it had been growing really, really fast for decades. It was a city of about 200,000 people. It had, of course, as the birthplace of General Motors, it was still, humming with industry and activity, really good paying jobs. It had a community schools program that was a national model where schools were seen as not just as places that you sent the kids from, I don't know, 8 a.m. to 3 p.m., that they became like sort of used as to meet needs of folks in the neighborhood throughout like all hours of the day. They had like adult education and cooking classes and whatever. A variety of other community needs were met through its community schools program. It was really quite innovative. It also was like full of trees. You know, I was looking at some of the old pictures in the Parks Department in the city of Flint. They had like 11 people just on their forestry division. They planted trees everywhere. It was really quite beautiful. Flint was also one of the most segregated cities in the country. By one measure, it was the most segregated city in the North and the third most segregated city nationwide. Really, really excruciatingly kept lines of where people could live based on their color and ethnicity. Which is part of why it was pretty amazing that they had the first African-American mayor in America. it was a little bit, you know, with an asterisk. I mean, it was the kind of government they had at the time. The mayor was more like a city council president, and he was appointed rather than elected. But it was still a pretty big deal. This guy, he worked at the Buick Foundry in Flint. His name was Floyd McCree. He was a World War II veteran. He lived in one of the two neighborhoods where black people could live, St. John's. And his role made national news. It got a lot of attention. There were a lot of profiles about who he was and what he wanted to do. A lot of attention was given to Flint because of his leadership role there. And because segregation was becoming such, I mean, it was morally wrong, but it was also becoming logistically untenable, right? You know, you had so many people coming. It's really pushing the limits of these like boundaries that we drew, right? You know, so you have so many people coming from the South through the Great Migration. You have two neighborhoods where you want to put them. And with more and more people coming, they're getting more and more crowded. There's more and more predatory landlords. It's just becoming just impossible. And folks were, you know, this is the civil rights movement was building up too, and folks were just like not having it anymore, right? And so one of the things that Mayor McCree really wanted to do was to push for fair housing in Flint so that people could live anywhere they wanted. And you know, of course, there was a number of ways the segregation was enforced, you know, from racially restrictive covenants where, you know, you were legally not allowed to sell your house to somebody who was not of the white race, or to the redlining maps. That's one from 1937 in Flint, where federal housing and insurance and mortgage policies were enforced segregation to a number of other ways that these lines were strictly kept. So it was a very complicated but important movement that was rising in Flint. In July 1967, of course, in Detroit, where I live, there was this huge uprising, rebellion, riot, right? You know, ultimately more than 40 people died. What's less known is that that same week, a number of other cities around Michigan erupted, including in Flint. What happened here is that there was a fair housing rally in North Flint, really near where that softball stadium was. And it died down, and a few rowdy teenagers hung around afterwards and started throwing things, and it kind of blew up as well. Now, the mayor did something really unusual. He and the county prosecutor worked together on this deal to release all 102 people arrested that first night with no charges, so long as they kept the peace the second night. And what's kind of wild is that it actually worked. It basically worked, you know, like with Flint, like it was in a state of emergency. There was like fires, there's property damage, there's a number of things going on, but it died down within 2 days, and there was very few serious injuries and no deaths compared to, you know, Detroit, where it was like 5 days and 2,000, you know, thousands injured. It was craziness. And the other thing that happened here is that the city commission that had been avoiding a fair housing ordinance decided, okay, we're going to vote on this. And so the mayor makes his plea. He's like, look, I fought in World War II. My brother fought in World War II. Our father fought in World War I. And yet the people that we fought in Europe can come to Flint and buy any house they want. and yet we can't. He's like, I urge you to like do the right thing here so that people can live anywhere they choose. And the city commission, you know, confers, and they vote it down. And they decide segregation is still how we're going to live here. And the mayor, literally that night, he weeps, and he's like, you know, when I was appointed to this position and we got a lot of national press, Everybody thought that was really great. You know, look how progressive Flint is. Look how much national attention Flint's getting. He's like, but I can't keep doing this. I can't keep living this equal opportunity lie. And he quits. And a number of other people resigned in solidarity with him. And this is, incidentally, beginning to get some national attention itself, you know, with the New York Times kind of noticing this. Black people and white people, you know, who are in public city positions left in support of the mayor. He ended up being hospitalized for an ulcer and exhaustion. And somebody comes to visit him. His name's Woody Etherly. He's 23 years old, and he's the mayor's nephew. And they start talking about, like, where do we even go from here? Like, we just had this really depressing vote. We're kind of coming out of, like, some fiery days, like, in this city and other cities in Michigan. Where do we even go if we're trying to bring more equality to the city? And what they decide to do, especially the younger guy, is that they decided they're going to do a sleep-in on the lawn of City Hall. So a bunch of young folks pull out their sleeping bags right that by that domed building. They pull out their sleeping bags and they say, we're not leaving until the city commission decides they're going to reconsider the fair housing ordinance. And they stayed there, even though there was sprinklers turned on and, you know, folks patrolling with guns being all intimidating, and they got more and more people joining them, as especially after there was like a 10-minute segment on the Huntley-Brinkley report about the rising fair housing movement in this infamously segregated GM city. And I was reading like stories of this, and people remembered somebody passing around like pancakes, you know, for breakfast, and nobody knows who made them. It's, you know, just there's folks who are supporting them even though they weren't sleeping in a bag on city lawn. And what's amazing here is that this, you could see this culture of community organizing mirrored at different points in Flint's history. You could see it, you know, before in the 1930s with the sit-down strike, right? Side note, while I was working on this, I found out that my great-grandfather was one of those sit-down strikers. I had no idea. But he was one of these people who worked at GM and decided that they were going to occupy a few different plants, bring one of the world's most powerful companies to a literal standstill, you know, because they wanted fairer wages, better, safer working conditions, including with paint, the right to collectively bargain. And what's wild is they literally won after 44 days. I mean, it was effectively the birth of the United Auto Workers, which had such an influence the 20th century in all kinds of ways. And you could see that culture of community organizing again in the 60s with the sleep-in folks, and in more recent years with the water crisis. In fact, a lot of the folks that I met who were part of this had come out of, you know, working at GM and being part of the union. They learned some of these same kind of tactics. Another one of the myths about, I think, the Flint water crisis, that folks just like endured it and then had it told that to them that it happened, but they were definitely agents of the story all along the way, even before people were paying attention and before they had any an empowered local government to hear them. So back to 1967 in Flint, they were supported, those sleep-in folks, by a unity rally that came together to support the fair housing movement and the mayor. 5,000 people came out to the lawn of City Hall to raise the consciousness, I guess, about fair housing, including the governor at the time, Republican George Romney, who was a big supporter of open housing. And so enough pressure had been building that the city commission's like, fine, okay, we'll vote. And again, it was watered down. The mayor returned to office to advocate for it, and by a hair, in October 1967, fair housing passes. So huge news, great, right? Wonderful, hooray. But within 5 minutes, there is a petition, democracy, right? Within 5 minutes, there is a petition to overturn the new ordinance. So the ordinance is suspended because they quickly got 5,000 people to support it, folks who opposed it. This included literally 50 known members of the Ku Klux Klan who had an actual robed parade down Saginaw Street to rally their cause, right? So the big vote is set for February 1968, and 40,000 people in Flint go to the polls to decide whether or not they're going to keep that fair housing ordinance or not. And I swear to God, it was actually only by 30 votes after the recount, it passes. And this is, you guys, I can't overstate how big of a deal it is. Flint was the first city in America to pass a fair housing ordinance by a popular vote. The first. It similar ones had come up in Seattle and Berkeley and Tacoma and Toledo and Akron. And I never liked Ohio anyway, but just pointed out. all of them were voted down. And nationally, a fair housing law seemed like it was never going to come. So just like the city commission in Flint, Congress was like dragging its feet and delay. It did end up happening a few months later, but only basically because Martin Luther King Jr. was shot. Like that was the, so to speak, the trigger that got them, you know, off their asses, frankly. So this was a huge, huge deal. And the folks in Flint had a lot to be proud of. But it too was bittersweet because that was in 1968. The 1970 census marked Flint's first ever downturn in population. Of course, there was shifts in the auto industry and the world economy. There was a lot of different forces at play, but it's also hard to miss the fact that Flint's population was rising up until both fair housing and school desegregation laws took effect, and then they started going down. And it's a downslide that has continued to this day. Flint today has about the same number of people as it had in 1920. Still one of the largest cities in the state, actually, but it's in that that trap, right? You know, this is a city that's lost more than half of its population, but that infrastructure, that drinking water infrastructure, did not shrink in accordance with them, right? So this leads to all kinds of problems. Not only is the drinking water system oversized for the number of people it's serving, but it was also overbuilt to serve that huge industrial base. Back in the 60s, General Motors was absorbing like 60% of Flint's total water use, right? So the pipes are also built with a larger than usual circumference to help, you know, GM. So nowadays, you've got fewer and poorer people who are shouldering the burden of maintaining such a water system. So even before we get to the water switch here in 2014, we've got a number of problems here. Like it mathematically doesn't work. I mean, Flint in 2014 was losing 50% of its water just through leaks. And they had literally some of the most expensive water bills in the entire nation. They were excessively expensive, not even accounting for the fact that it's a disproportionately poor community because, you know, they're literally just trying to patch their way through. It is a real problem. So bringing it back, this history of infrastructure inequality directly relates to the water crisis in a number of other ways. So if you go to Flint, you're still going to see a lot of these really beautiful historic houses, right? You know, neighborhoods that are more dense. You can see, you can feel this like legacy of wealth that this community had. But you're also going to see, you know, the spaces that people left behind, right? Like there's just a lot of empty space when you remove all these big, huge plants and half the people. And besides having creating a number of problems for the public sector, including that over expensive and water, it also literally made the water worse during the water crisis, because when you have water moving through a neighborhood that has a lot of vacancy, it moves more slowly through the pipes, right? Or it might even sit stagnant for a long time. So if you can picture some of that corrosion, it just gets more saturated, right? So the folks who lived in neighborhoods that look like this were more likely to see discolored water than the folks that lived in neighborhoods where the water was moving more quickly, right? So everybody in Flint was affected by the water crisis, right? All kinds of people, all races, residents especially, children especially, but also commuters and college students. And like, there's a wide net for this who was impacted by this water crisis. But repeating their patterns of inequality, some people were affected more because we have neighborhoods that where we have concentrated our poverty. Or another way to put that is we have concentrated our vulnerability. They are more vulnerable. And these are the communities that are, not coincidentally, disproportionately people of color and disproportionately poor. So this has got us into this strange situation where, you know, I noticed this like while working on this. This is actually a map of Baltimore, but you could see how the patterns of how lead impacts people, it's not news, right? It's not news at all. Like there's, people noticed that, you can see this, that's from 1951 records reveal 9 deaths, most cases in slum areas, you know, in Baltimore. Like people have been noticing it for decades how, while lead is everywhere in our country, and we really gotta deal with it, the places where we have purposefully disinvested in, where we have purposefully concentrated vulnerability, are in fact more at risk with literal life and death consequences. Again, when with children, exposure to lead can cause permanent and irreversible brain damage, nerve damage, developmental delays. For adults too, it's toxic. It can especially cause a lot of reproductive challenges like miscarriages, stillbirths, fertility issues. It is serious, and just because it's sort of common, like that we have lead pipes and lead in our, you know, soil and stuff, does not make it normal or safe. And this is just kind of underlying the fact that there was, you know, what happened in Flint is unique in many ways. I'm going to quote here Congressman Dan Kildee. He likes to say that he represents Flint. He says, Flint is not a worst case scenario, it's a warning. Because again, the traces of the lead that we put into our environment are still with us in all kinds of communities. With leaded paint, like that's no longer sold, so great, but of course it's still in many homes and schools and hospitals and places. We haven't had a remediation effort that is on par to its prevalence. With leaded fuel, which way back in 1925, like we could see, here's another little side note, it's amazing. You know who has the leading role in creating leaded fuel? Charles Kettering, the GM guy who has a school in Flint named after him. What the hell? Like he was a genius, right? He was a genius. He invented things, he invented the like incubator for premature children, the starter for cars. And also this, there was all these headlines in the mid-20s about how it was literally making workers who handled it insane. There was one factory in New Jersey that was nicknamed the House of the Butterflies because people were hallucinating these little fluttering things in their periphery. The Surgeon General like put the kibosh on it and was like, okay, we're gonna bring people from the industry and some public health people, we're gonna talk about it, like what should we do? And it was this real interesting and difficult conversation about whether, as a society, somebody needs to prove a product causes harm before they sell it, or if people need to prove it's safe before they sell, or you know, like what do we need to prove? Like, do if they're gonna sell this, like, do they absolutely have to prove it's safe first, or do the people who are concerned have to prove without a doubt that it's unsafe? You know, it was this really interesting debate that gets at the challenge of public health stuff, and especially with something like lead, where it's not visible, it accumulates over time. No one source is probably going to be the only source of lead. It's a difficult thing. You can see the patterns, but for any single case, it's challenging. Anyway, leaded fuel, happily, no longer sold. The last gallon of leaded fuel was sold in 1996, actually, although that was like a 20-year shutdown. But that legacy of that remains with us too, because through fumes, exhaust from the cars, it's spread everywhere, you know, from the ice caps to our gardens. And lead pipes, too. That's a little emblem. Lead pipes were first used in Rome. That was part of Rome's genius, was like having this really wonderful drinking water system. And while it's not a theory that has a lot of credibility behind it, but it has been proposed by actual historians, there have been some who have suggested that the fall of the Roman Empire and these mad emperors might have something to do with drinking water out of lead pipes. But we built our drinking water infrastructure all across the country with something that is toxic to people, where no amount is safe. We don't put new pipes made of lead into our environment anymore. That's great, but most of us live in a home that, or go to school in a place, or work in a place that just might have been built before, you know, the first ban in 1986 and the real ban in 2014. From 8% of lead was still allowed in the 1986 homes. Anyway, the point being, this isn't just Flint's story. And just to kind of bring it back out to these beautiful Great Lakes that I love so much and that I know you do too, I feel like one of the things I was really thinking about a lot when I was working on this book was how, I mean, I was thinking about how water makes us, it forces us to be honest. We can't hide from the past. When we pollute water, it comes back to haunt us, right? It reveals how we're all connected, even despite ourselves. You know, that Flint River, it doesn't just go through the city. It goes through suburbs and rural areas and agricultural areas and flows up into the wildlife refuge. Communities that are really different from each other are ecologically connected, and each one is affected by what happens in the other in an immediate way. And while this is challenging in many ways and forces us to deal with a lot of stuff that I think many of us would prefer not to deal with, but it's also really quite beautiful. And I think if we think about our cities in a way that honors that and thinks about our infrastructure not as a way to separate us, you know, like we did with like redlining maps, but ways that acknowledge how infrastructure is literally the way to invite people into a community to say that you belong and you belong and you belong and you belong, and through this like life-giving force of water, it's really beautiful. I mean, why do we all live in cities in the first place, right? It's because we need each other. You know, I don't want to go to the river and go get my bucket of water. I don't want to think about like how to treat it to get rid of cholera. We need the genius of each other. This is the whole point of democracy. It's the whole point of communities. It's the whole point of cities. It's why we are all in this together. And I think as hard as the water crisis is and what it reveals about communities even beyond Flint, I think there's also a lot of wonderful ways we can learn from this and create more inclusive, beautiful, equitable, joyful, healthy communities in the future. And then another thing I wanted to mention about Flint too is like, you guys, these folks are really great about helping each other out even before they understood what's going on. I think that's another way we can learn from what happened with this water crisis. I mean, most of you know, like the water switch happened in 2014. There wasn't an official acknowledgement of the crisis until October of 2015, so like a year and a half. And this is quite a problem when the pipes are getting measurably worse. You know, the toxins are more and more bad. The cumulative effect of lead is adding up with each day that goes by. And it wasn't that folks weren't doing everything they could think of to draw attention to this. Besides demonstrations and protests, they were like going to Lansing, they were talking to their public officials, they were writing letters. There were folks who were trying to map out like symptoms to try to figure out what was going on. Like your kid has a rash, they were trying to draw it out. Even before lead was on the radar, they were just trying to see what was going on. And they started running their own bottled water drives well before the state or the federal government was doing it, just to help each other out. And I think that I think when we think about like how to like hold on to civic trust despite incredible odds, I think that's a really powerful lesson that Flint has. And that's all I have to say, but I'd love to hear from you folks. So thank you very much. I think there's a microphone there, and also, despite the microphone, I will also repeat the question just for to include our fella in the back there.
First of all, thanks for coming. Okay. The more we can learn, the better. But I don't understand the disconnect of the water when another source wasn't going to be for 2 years. What was the thinking behind sort of an imaginary solution that wasn't in place yet?
That is a great question, and it's showing up in courtrooms near you. Because it is very confusing. And again, when I was working on this, I would try to go back there and I'd be like, what information did people have at the time? You know, like, what are we dealing with here? What was the understanding? What was communicated to the people, the community, was that they're switching to the KWA, but it wasn't ready yet. And the reason, unlike neighboring suburban communities that also were continuing on with the KWA, they were going to leave Detroit now and treat their own water at the river. So why do this? The going story is that, you know, they did this to save money, like in a sort of austerity thing. But even that is very confusing, because if you look, I mean, it's not actually cheaper to start your own water system, like, which is kind of what they're doing with a more complex water source. I mean, theoretically, they sort of were, like, they could save the money they were paying to Detroit. They sold, this was left out of a lot of what was told the public at the time, but they sold a key pipeline to the KWA that they needed to connect to Detroit. So that they had an interest in that. But it's all of it's just very confusing. It's what people were told, that Detroit forced them off. That Detroit's like, look, you voted to join the KWA. Well, by April of 2014, we're going to cut you off. You know, and so Flint, you know, the emergency manager said, like, needed to go to its own river source just to keep water flowing. But that doesn't make sense when there is neighboring suburbs that also didn't have an active contract with Detroit, and they just kept paying their bill and then seamlessly went on to the KWA a couple years later. So why did Flint have to? This is one of the questions that I am kind of hoping that the court process sheds more light on, because even the did it to save money narrative doesn't quite make sense, because even if everything had gone smoothly, it's not clear how it would have saved money.
Whose idea was it to begin the KWA? Where did the funding come from? Why was it needed, or why did they say it was needed?
I see we have a fellow journalist in the room. No, those are good questions. The question here, right, as I neglected to repeat the question last time, but question here was like, whose idea was it to start the KWA? What was the reasoning behind it and the money around it? So the KWA has been, the Carroll County Water Authority has been sort of talked about for a very long time. Its biggest champion is somebody named Jeff Wright, who is the Genesee County Drain Commissioner, so in charge of the county's water. And he is also the, last I checked, president of the KWA. The narrative when they were trying to draw a permit, you know, to start a brand new water system in Michigan, which is, just to be clear, like kind of an unusual thing to do when there's not a problem with water supply or water quality. It is kind of an unusual thing nowadays to start a brand new water system. But what they wanted to do is to, they're like, we're going to set up this new water system. It'll serve mid-Michigan communities, kind of from, you know, drawing a line from like Flint basically out to Lake Huron. This will give us more local control, more like self-sufficiency over water. They're frustrated with Detroit's water system in particular. They don't feel like they have a lot of agency there. There have been other when a lot of this decision was happening with Flint leaving the Detroit water system for the KVUA, there was a lot of attention on it because Flint was, outside of Detroit itself, the largest customer of the Detroit water system, and Detroit was about to go into bankruptcy. So it was a very big, you know, deal that Flint left Detroit's water system at that time. And also quite curious that there are emergency managers both in Flint and Detroit, yet a deal could not be negotiated or that was satisfactory. It's just interesting. But they, yeah, it was like, they, I feel like they, this was, it's hard for me to understand in certain ways too, but like there's some resistance to this decision because there's, if like opponents were saying that it's kind of, it's harming the other public utility. It's environmentally like unnecessary. It's kind of contributing to this like fragmented culture. Michigan already has more water systems than like basically any other state because everybody likes having their own little water system, which is a challenge for the state to regulate. You know, like the MDQ's water department that oversees water stuff. I mean, they've lost a huge amount of their staffing and budget over the last like 10 years, and that has an effect on their ability to supervise so many different water systems. The money came from a lot of different, like different sources, but one big one was Flint, and this is part of the court cases too. So, Flint was. So, under the emergency management, under the contract they signed, was set to pay a third of the construction cost of the KWA. And this was, and it would do this by going into debt. So this was surprising because Flint was being broke and having many needs, was already at its legal debt limit. And so folks with the MDEQ and with the KWA kind of worked together on this like workaround, this kind of faux environmental problem at the Flint water system, that where with in which they embedded the entire KWA contract. In other words, they found a little kind of like loophole to be able to get Flint to be able to borrow money to go to the KWA, even though Flint was no longer legally allowed to borrow money. So an emergency manager sent to the city because it's broke, and theoretically to get rid of redundancies and you know, make the hard decisions and balance a budget, put the city $80 million more in debt, not for public safety or schools or a number of other needs the community had, but to duplicate a water something it already had, which is get Lake Huron water to the city. Strange. Okay.
Hi. By the way, my husband's grandmother worked at the GM plant after the death of her husband. They called her girl because she was the only girl on the floor. And she brought food to your grandfather during the sit down.
Oh, that's so sweet. I love it. Yeah, they had like, a, I can't remember what they called it. There was like a little. They had the Women's League or something like that. They're like handing food through the windows, and that's cool.
Yeah, so my husband's family is comedians in Flint. Last member just moved out last year. My question is, in your book, you talk about that there were crises with lead in Washington, D.C. previous to this. We didn't pay much attention. Flint got more national attention, maybe. But and there's been a few cities like Lansing that you talk about in the book. They've been very proactive. I used to live in Lansing. It's a nice place. But one thing that I think is interesting, although we see in the paper a lot of articles about all these cities have lead problems, I feel like there's still a lack of commitment and will to solve this problem.
Yeah.
But I'd like you to talk about that as an issue that we, and how can we help bring this issue, you know, to our leaders, the politicians, the people who are in charge, to do something to protect the future.
I love that question. Yeah. So her question is like about how do we, even when there's local coverage of of high lead levels and problems with lead pipes. And even when there's a lead and water crisis in the nation's capital, where some of the most powerful people in the world lived, and yet, yet there's still this kind of sense of complacency around dealing with it. I think that's true. I think there's a number of reasons for it. For like one, as always, I guess throughout, ever since, folks in the 1920s were arguing about leaded fuel and lost, it always seems like there's some more urgent need, right? And there are, there's so many urgent needs. There's so many things to pay attention to, especially problems that are new, that have a new kind of crisis. It can be more galvanizing, and especially with something like lead pipes. I mean, you bring it up, and like you can get a glazed look over your eye, right? I mean, I have never thought I would spend so much time thinking about pipes as I have over the last few years. I mean, you guys know. I mean, we're debating in Michigan what to do with our like terrible roads, and we all see that and look at them every day. I mean, to get people to think about the infrastructure we can't see is challenging. And we live in a state again with so much abundance. I mean, we do take for granted our water, right? Like we unlike our friends in Arizona or whatever, we're not used to it being a threat. We're not used to the idea that it might be inaccessible, we don't have that sort of immediate sense of urgency. And with lead too, I think you also have that challenge of mistaken, and here I'm paraphrasing a really pioneering physician who is a big anti-lead advocate in the 20th century. We do mistake what's common for what's normal, and we have just gotten used to, like, if it's like, I drank out of a lead pipe when I was a kid and I'm alive, like, what's the harm? It's sometimes hard to see, and this is like, I guess when we're thinking about like what to do to break through the complacency, like one is to be able to tell better stories and see stories better, and as a pattern, like it's not always easy to see the consequences of lead contamination or lead pipes, individual by individual by individual, but you can see the patterns if you pan out and look at it as a community. You could map it, like those places. I mean, it's just real. I think I'd love to see us as a culture grow better at telling stories, be able to understand stories better on that communal level, and to have that resonate with us as much as like a tragic tale of like one particular person, I think too, stories like Lansing and like Madison and communities that have, despite all odds, did invest in lead, like getting rid of their lead infrastructure, are helpful because it shows it can be done. I think a lot of times there's a sort of helplessness, like, well, we don't have any money to do anything, like how can we possibly fund this? It's complicated with ownership and private property, it's too hard. And when you can show some communities that have done it, and in Madison, Wisconsin, and Lansing's cases, they did it without waiting for like a clear and present danger. They just did it because they knew it was the right thing to do. And built it in over time, and they did it. And I think that like that can give us something that makes it feel like we do have a choice. Like we don't have to settle for where we're at now. Like it can be energizing to know that there are concrete things we can do. I think that can help. Thank
you. Good evening.
Hello.
Recent articles have indicated that some state DEQ administrators or officials would be put on trial for criminal negligence. What did they do, and what incentive could they have had to not be honest about what the conditions are?
Sure. I mean, he's asking what, if putting MDQ or Environmental Department staff on filing criminal charges, very serious ones, and also folks with our Health and Human Services Department, like what did they do to warrant such charges, and why would they ever do such a thing? Like, what's your motive here? That's what's so strange about this story, you guys. It doesn't fit the usual sort of environmental injustice formula. This isn't like an Aaron Brockovich story, right? Like the folks who made poor decisions here or public agencies. In the case of folks with the Environmental Department in particular, several of them have recently had plea deals, so they aren't going to be going on to trial. But just to start with where the charges were, there are a number of problems. Like, one was, first of all, supervising the switch to the water department and actively excluding corrosion control from the treatment process, which was breaking federal law. And then later on, when the EPA was asking questions, I think it's fair to say actively misleading the EPA about whether or not they were using corrosion control. Like, there's emails about this. EPA is like, what kind of corrosion control are you using? How could the water be looking like this? And their answers seem very, they're like suggestive, as if they do have a corrosion control plan without ever being specific about what it is. It's very weird. Other folks have been charged with fraud, I guess, for this bond deal, and kind of having this kind of workaround that was a way to finance the EP or finance the KWA without, you know, getting around the legal debt limit. In the case of the Health and Human Services Department, those charges are mostly based on, first of all, like, not making public the fact that there was this Legionnaires outbreak. Like, that's a big one. That's where, like, these involuntary manslaughter charges are coming from, because even doctors in the area weren't alerted. So folks who had compromised immune systems that might have been able to make better choices about, you know, for their health had they known that there was this risk, you know, that's where those charges are coming from. And there was also a key report about children's blood levels that prosecutors allege was modified to make it seem like Flint kids' blood lead levels were not on the rise, when in fact they were, since the water switch. It's a hot mess, honestly. And when you think about, like, why, you know, I think there's a number of different people, and who even knows. I mean, I think there can be a number of different reasons, but I think, some of it, I think, gets at the idea of, like, I think folks really thought that they could just keep kind of kicking the can down. You know, like, when there first started being problems, they're like, oh, it's just going to be temporary anyway. Oh, it's fine. Oh, we can just, like, we don't have to do that much. Let's do the bare minimum, you know, just to try to get to that next water switch. Even there was that huge, remember the huge GM engine plant that within 5 months they noticed the water was corroding their parts, and it was serious enough that they switched to a suburbs water that was still getting water from Detroit. And if that's not a red flag, I don't know what is. Like, but it still took the state a year to acknowledge that maybe if it's not safe for the machinery, maybe it's also not safe for people. Like, I don't, that's crazy, you know? I think there's a lot of different issues for why it was easy to dismiss this community, and not just by folks who work at the state, but other journalists, including myself, environmental groups, universities. Like, why did, you know, again, there are colleges in Flint, like, where, you know, like, maybe they could have played a larger role in unveiling what happened. There's a lot, I think, to parse out here, which is why I think it's worth reflecting on, because clearly no community deserves this, and we want to make sure it never happens again anywhere.
Thank you for a very informative presentation. Dr. Mona Hanna-Patisha is credited with coming up with much of the documentation that helped to expose and prove the water crisis. Who were some of the other heroes and heroines that finally were successful in bringing attention to it?
What a great question. So she's asking about who were the people, like, including Dr. Mona Hanna-Patisha, the pediatrician who played a role in unveiling what was going on, who else was part of that. And that's one reason I was really interested in this story too. It wasn't like just one cowboy hero from the outside who came in and was like, everybody, guess what? The water's bad. It really truly was an ensemble story. And in that too, I think it's there's a lot to learn here. First and foremost, there was a number of community residents that really went above and beyond in tracking what was happening and going through every possible public channel to make themselves heard and visible and try to understand what's going on. And had they not been there, nothing else would have happened. One in particular, a resident named Leanne Walters, whose family was very much impacted by the water, especially her two little twin boys. She ended up working with a guy at the EPA in Chicago. His name's Miguel Del Toro. He kind of went a little bit outside his normal purview and tested at her home, found really shocking amounts of lead. Like the average was like nearly at hazardous waste levels of 30 different samples from her home. And he wrote a report, a memo, a draft report, that outlined not only what was going on at her house, but also why it would be a citywide problem, not just a single person's house. And the reason being for like how the water was tested and sampled was, you know, he was able to show how it was misleading. He was like the first to kind of articulate this like corrosion control gap, which he worked with Leanne to, you know, confirm was so. And this draft report was the first thing that interrupted the dynamic where the residents say it's bad, the state says it's fine. And it just got stuck there for like a year. And suddenly you had somebody who's recognized as an expert affirming what the residents say. It's the first thing that kind of changed that story. Leanne passed that memo to Kurt Guyette, who is the former Alt Weekly reporter who was working with the ACLU. He reached out to the MDQ. He tried to understand what was coming from them. They never responded to him, though they talked about it in their emails. He wrote a thing about it and published the whole memo. Michigan Radio picked that up. And then suddenly the questions journalists are asking are a little bit more challenging and have more data behind them. That was a big step, and both, I think, Leanne and Miguel deserve credit for that. And another big thing that happened was that the residents who were very actively like trying to collaborate with outside experts to figure out what was going on ended up working with a team at Virginia Tech University to do a citywide test, basically the same thing that was done at Leanne's house, but citywide, to confirm it was a citywide issue. They distributed like 300 samples, sampling kits. They got 277 back. The residents did this like full-on canvassing. So the data, Virginia Tech was able to test it, and they were able to show that like, you know, the pattern of how the water had worsened over time. And this was a really clutch thing. It was able to show that there was a citywide lead in water problem, though still there wasn't any real response. And this is where the pediatrician kind of played a role, because she was able to show it's not just in the water, it's in the kids. You know, there kept having to be like one more thing you had to show before something else happened. So that's an overview. There's a number of other folks who I would call heroes, but I guess that's a big one. It's an interesting question. Sure, yeah, like she's asking, is there anybody as qualified at Virginia Tech to do what they did? Sure, yes. I do know, and it's important to note that like since then, there have been university researchers, well, really from all over the country, but it's including those at Michigan State, University of Michigan, Wayne State, who in particular have a collaborative that have been tracking a lot of the Legionnaires, you know, stuff, trying to investigate more of that. There have been a number of other universities and researchers who have been doing quite a lot in Flint since then. For that particular test, like the guy who was at the center of that Virginia Tech team was also part of the Washington, D.C. kind of story, and was sort of like considered the nation's like lead and water expert. That was one reason Miguel, the EPA guy, referred residents to him. That's how kind of how they got involved with this. Beyond that, if other folks like wanted to get involved or didn't want to get involved, I don't know. Like, it would have been lovely to have seen more universities like do that same test there, but it, for a number of reasons, some that I'm sure are just chance, it just didn't happen.
Yes, sir.
I have two things. I don't think you mentioned the video that talks about a lot of the things you mentioned, and a lot of the heroes, and a lot of the heroines, and a lot of the families, and Kurt Guyette, and you know the video?
I mean, I feel like it could be a couple of them, but they did make, like, if you're talking about like ones that he made early on about?
No.
Okay.
A full production video.
There could be a few. But tell me about it. Like, what makes it stand out?
I don't know the name of it. That's thought you might have found it in your research. Let me go to my second topic. What is the status of the pipe replacement project, which was a big deal?
Great.
But I've heard nothing about that at this point.
Sure.
Is it 100% complete? Is it 80? Have they just quit doing it? Are they comfortable with the level that they're now at with every home in Flint with this problem? What is the status of that situation?
Great question. What is the status of the pipe replacement thing? So yeah, that was one of the reasons why, like, Flint switched back to Detroit Water in October of 2015, but the reason the water wasn't immediately safe is because the pipes got so damaged, and even when you have properly treated water going through it, like, at a certain point, it's just broke, right? So it wasn't until, first of all, there was some delay because the state didn't offer to do a pipe replacement. It only came out of a class action settlement, so it took a while for that to kind of get through. But there was a class action settlement that compelled them to fund the replacement of these pipes. And it's been a bit of a journey since. there's always kind of questions about, like, how much and contractors. And one of the challenges was, where even are the pipes? You know, almost no community has kept records of precisely where you're supposed to dig. You know, I mean, and nobody wants to waste time, like, just digging trenches all over the city. I mean, there are some real challenges with this. It's mostly unprecedented. Most cities have not done this, but the good news is there has been, you know, the pipe replacement has been going on for several years at this point. It's continuing. That's another reason people might say that the water crisis isn't over is because not every pipe has been replaced yet. That's not due for another year or so, assuming they stay kind of on track with where they're at. It's also, you know, just because of the nature of it, because it's such a huge, like, construction system is a project that even if, like, the pipe in my home is replaced with copper, which is what they're doing, the fact that, you know, there's some construction happening over there, it kind of shakes up the whole system. And so that's one reason why people are still advised to kind of drink out of, like, lead certified, you know, taps, and one reason why they're still doing their own bottled water drives. The state did about a year ago April, seize the bottled water distribution centers that it was operating for a while. They cited a few different rounds of tests that showed that the lead had been going down, which is good news, but a lot of folks in Flint still feel very skeptical for a number of reasons. One is they want the whole system to be replaced. First, two, lead wasn't the only thing they worried about, so just citing the lead test wasn't, you know, enough to satisfy some folks. And three, you're in this very awkward position where the very same agencies that said it was safe before are the ones who are saying it's safe now. So even if they're 100% doing their job right, you know, like the DEQ folks are 100% doing their job right, and they're like, we're sampled it properly, we can say that the lead it's at normal levels again. It's, you know, just folks are like, why should I believe you? You said that before. I mean, it's part of the cost of this crisis, right? Is like, it just takes a while to not just get trust back, but show that you're worthy of that trust.
Tesla.
Oh, that Elon Musk guy? Yeah.
Right, but there's a new project in the school systems. Can you talk about that?
Well, honestly, I don't know too much about it, so I don't want to speak out of turn. She was asking about, you know, there have been a number of folks, including Elon Musk, the guy famous with Tesla, offering to try to do things to help. Particularly, like, schools is a big one, right? I mean, these are, you know, when children are most at risk, and a lot of school buildings are older buildings that very likely have older infrastructure, it's a real thing. One thing I learned while working on this water crisis is there is no rule, no federal rule, that you need to test water at schools or daycare centers despite the vulnerability of children. And at least when I wrote this, I think there were only six states that required it. I think a few more have added it on in the wake of Flint because they've gotten worried, but most people just don't have to check, and so they don't. Because what are you going to do if you find out there's high lead? You know, like it's a hard problem to fix. And it takes not just one individual. So I don't know specifically about like what his project is, so I don't want to speak too much about it in particular, but I do hope that what happened in Flint does spark the innovative spirit across a lot of us in America to figure out some solutions to like not just make our lives better, but make our bodies better, like make our communities better. I mean, I think it's time for people to get excited about the kind of engineering and design and possibility and prosperity that can come from doing drinking water systems right. I mean, the fact that we have them at all is kind of a miracle, you guys, and that didn't happen easily. They were hard fought, they were complicated, they were strange. What works in one place doesn't work in another. They're money losing operations. They started private in many places. And then when people realized this is not a profitable enterprise, they're like, take it, city. But my God, how much better are our lives because we have tap water, you know? We have been saved from like untold diseases. Our economy has been able to grow. Like it's powerful stuff. And then I think we feel like we kind of ticked that box and then we just sat down. But if like folks like Elon Musk or whoever, maybe somebody named who isn't as famous, gets excited about like, we can do this better and healthier and safer for people, then great, let's all in.
I just am interested in shifting gears a little bit, and I'm wondering if you could just a little bit, what led you to write this book and the process of writing the book?
Sure, fun question. She asked about what led me to writing the book at all and that process. Honestly, like looking back, I feel like I just dreamed everything. Everything that happened over the past 3 years is like a hallucination. I was just telling my friend, like, I feel like I kind of like am coming out of a coma. Well, I'm a full-time journalist and I write for a number of different publications and I've often written about urban policy and how cities work and don't work, and especially being in Detroit over the last 10 years, there's been a lot to write about, and I've learned a lot about, you know, how cities work and don't work, and the historic reasons for them, the current day reasons for them. I've written about a lot of the same things that were clearly playing out in Flint, and that led me to start doing articles about Flint. Especially as it's the water crisis was escalating, though I want to not overstate things. I like a lot of people, I should have been there sooner. I remember seeing little articles about, you know, this switch is not going well, and I think of myself, like, why didn't I go there sooner? I mean, it's something I have to carry. But I did start doing articles about it, and it was pretty clear that even when you're doing a long article, and even with that insane global spotlight that came for a while, it was clear that there was a lot that was lost and missing, and it definitely deserved a longer look that could follow all these different threads. And what happened is that somebody reached out based on one of the articles and asked if I would be interested in doing it as a book, and I was flattered, but I was honestly cautious about like whether I should be the one to do it, whether she was just interested in exploiting that spotlight and wanted to do like a slapdash kind of thing, which is not what I would be into. But fortunately, she was wonderful and really thoughtful and had this wonderful reading list of all these cool books that could be models, and many were, and kind of coached me in how to put together a book proposal. And suddenly, boom, that's what I was doing for the next couple years. So that was it.
If anyone has a book that they'd like to sign, it will be available.
Sure.
And
thank
you very much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. This is wonderful. It really is great.
Another 30 seconds.